part three, the if section, investing and financing section. Part one and part two, it was the operating section, O, and now it's the if, investing and financing. I mentioned previously that the order is very important. Oh, if only I can pass my car exam. And yes, you will pass your car exam. Okay, so what about the investing and the financing section? First, I would like to tell you that you can make your own flashcards, okay? This is a good comparison between the investing and the financing section. You can write it down on a piece of paper and review it the day of the exam. Just read your notes the day of the exam. What is reported under the investing section and what is reported under the financing section? When we talk about the investing section, it's non-current assets. All the non-current assets, like fixed assets. The purchase of fixed assets is reported in the investing section for the amount of cash. Obviously, it's always for the amount of cash. This is the statement of cash flows. The sale of fixed assets as well, it's reported for the amount of cash. If I'm telling you the following, okay, obviously, we will solve many examples. So do not worry if you do not understand the concept right now. I'm selling a fixed asset with the cost of $100,000, accumulated depreciation of $40,000, and a carrying amount of $60,000 for $40,000. I just care about the cash. I sold it for $40,000. This is it, $40,000. This is the amount that is reported in the investing section. So the purchase of fixed asset and the sale of fixed asset for the amount of cash, investing section. The purchase of stock of another company, investing or investment in stock, is a non-current asset from the investor's point of view. Okay, I'm the orange company. Look at my top, my t-shirt's very nice. Thank you, my sister. It's an orange co, okay? It purchased a stock in gray co, my jeans. So orange co purchased a stock in gray co. Orange co is the investor. From the point of view of orange co, this is an investment in a sub. The sub is gray code. And this is reported in the investing section. If I'm purchasing a stock in gray code for $10,000, so this $10,000 is reported in the investing section and it's a purchase. So I'm paying cash, it's a minus $10,000. Always pay attention. Is it a purchase or is it a sale? If you're selling something, you're gaining cash. Your cash will increase. It's a positive figure. If you're purchasing something, you're paying cash. Pay. Nobody likes to pay cash. You're paying cash. It's a negative figure. Okay. What about the purchase of equity securities? It's in the investing section. Purchase of equity securities, like purchase of available for sale securities. Please. Now it's a very important point and I want you to pay attention to it. Purchase of bonds payable. We all know that bonds payable are held to maturity securities, okay? When they tell you that they are purchasing bonds payable, this is reported in the investing section. It's not like proceeds from issuance of bonds. It's not like retirement of bonds. No, this is a purchase of equity securities. Purchase of available for sale securities, purchase of held to maturity securities, purchase of bonds payable. So whenever you see bonds payable, some students just think, oh, bonds payable, it means financing section. No, it's not correct, it's incorrect. When you see bonds payable, look, are they talking about the issuance, the proceeds from the issuance? Are they talking about the payment for the retirement of the bonds? Or are they just telling you that they are purchasing some bonds payable? If they are purchasing bonds payable, it's in the investing section, okay? And two more points, purchase of US Treasury notes if the maturity is more than 3 months or 90 days. Why? Purchase of US Treasury notes, maturity more than 3 months. Okay, cash and cash equivalents. What is the definition of cash and cash equivalents? Cash and cash equivalents, okay, these are the following. It's short term, I'm talking about the short term, 3 months or 90 days or less, they are highly liquid. If the US Treasury notes, okay, it's like 60 days, the maturity is 60 days, and obviously it's highly liquid, then it is considered as a part of the cash and cash equivalent, and it's no longer reported in the investing section. The maturity day is very important, okay? You have to read carefully. Is it 90 days or 3 months or less? If it's less, it's a cash and cash equivalent. If it's more, obviously, it is then reported in the investing section. And I would like to mention here that no post-dated checks in cash and cash equivalents. Okay, pay attention. No post-dated checks. and no legally restricted deposits. So the deposited checks are not included in the cash and cash equivalents, and the legally restricted deposits are not included in the cash and cash equivalents. This is a parenthesis, obviously. And an acquisition of certificate of deposit is reported in the investing section. Acquisition of certificate of deposit. That's a negative figure. It's a minus, okay? You're acquiring a certificate of deposit. We will see it in a small example in a bit later. So this is everything related to the investing section. When I talk about the investing section, I'm talking about the non-current assets, fixed assets, purchase and sale of fixed assets, purchase of stock of another company. I'm talking about the purchase of equity securities, available for sale securities, held to maturity securities like bonds payable, purchase of US Treasury notes if the maturity is for more than 3 months, and acquisition of certificate of deposit, COD, it's a minus figure. What about the financing section? This is the symbol of financing section. For not to write the financing at each time, I just write this symbol. I report the debt, including the non-current liabilities, in the financing section, and the equity in the financing section. I want you to pay attention to something, because while solving the MCQs, you will do a mistake. Yes, remember what I'm saying, you will do that mistake. The current notes payable. Students think that current notes payable, it's a current liability. And because it is a current liability, it is reported in the operating section or under the operating section. This is incorrect. So, why? Current notes payable. Current NP. NP, no problem. No, there's a problem. There's a problem and a big problem. Why? Because the current notes payable are an exception to the rule. There are current liabilities, but they are not reported under the operating section. They are reported here in the financing section. So whenever you see current notes payable, no problem. There's a problem because it's an exception to the rule. And the current portion of the long-term debt is reported under the financing section as well, okay? Dividends paid, obviously, the dividends you pay to your shareholders is reported in the financing section, okay? And you will get trapped by something. They might tell you the dividends declared. Who cares? They are just declared. They are not paid. If the dividends are received, I will take it into consideration in the operating section. And if the dividends are paid, I will take the dividends paid into consideration under the financing section. If they just tell me that the dividends are declared, the dividends declared DD, I don't care about DD. Dividends declared. Who cares about the DD? No one, they are just declared. I care about them if they are paid or received. Paid, financing section, and received, operating. We saw that in the direct method, the bar two. Obviously, the proceeds from sale, this is the keyword, proceeds from sale, proceeds from issuance. Issuance and sale, it's the same, okay, equal. Proceeds from sale of common stock, buyback of treasury stock, because common stock, equity, treasury stock, equity, okay? So proceeds from sale of common stock or buyback of treasury stock. Proceeds from issuance of bonds or long-term debt. We saw that proceeds from issuance of bonds, it's financing. Purchase of bonds payable, it's investing. If they say payment for the retirement of long-term bonds payable, it's in the financing section and it's for the amount of cash, not for the current value of the bonds. What does that mean? I will tell you, I'm paying for the retirement of long-term bonds payable, $10,000, okay? And the carrying value of the bonds payable is $9,000. Who cares about the carrying value of the bonds payable? This is the statement of cash flows. I care about the amount of cash. Payment, it's a negative figure because I'm paying $10,000, okay? And capital lease payment, leases, you know that you have the operating leases and the financing or capital lease. Whenever you have a capital lease payment, it is reported under the financing section. So, this is like a flashcard. It's a quick comparison between investing and financing section. You have to write it down, okay? And, okay, I want you to know the following. Overdraft accounts, what about overdraft accounts? It's the following. The bank give me a facility, okay? They give me money, okay? I have to give them their money back. Overdraft. Under US GAAP, the overdraft accounts are reported under the financing section. So if the problem or the simulation you have to solve is talking about the US GAAP standards, you have to report the overdraft under the financing section. But if you are following the IFRS, the International Financial Reporting Standards, the overdrafts are considered as a part of the cash and cash equivalents. So you put it with the cash and cash equivalents under IFRS, but you report it under the financing section when you follow the US GAAP. Okay? Whew, a lot of info, a lot of interesting info. Now I want you to pay attention to the following. Sometimes while solving a simulation or an MCQ, they will tell you the following. They are converting some preferred stock into common stock. The carrying value is $100,000. They are just converting PS into common stock. Converting preferred stock into common stock. Conversion. This is a non-cash item. Obviously, it has to be disclosed. Yes, you will disclose it. But that does not affect the operating, nor the investing, nor the financing section. If they are telling you as well, they are converting bonds to equity. Just, it's a conversion. No cash is involved. It's a non-cash item. This is to be disclosed, but it's not reported under the operating, nor the investing, nor the financing section. If I'm telling you that I'm exchanging my bonds for stock, I'm exchanging bonds for stock. Who cares? It's just an exchange. Cash is not involved. It's a disclosure. Okay, it's not reported under the operating or the investing or the financing section. If I'm telling you that I'm purchasing an asset with a note, or if I'm telling you that I'm purchasing an asset by the issuance of stock, okay, I'm purchasing an asset with a note or by issuance of stock. No cash is involved. This is only to be disclosed. So this is a disclosure. Okay, this is a disclosure. This is not reported under the operating, nor the investing, nor the financing section, because cash is not involved. All I care about is cash. We all need cash to party, to go out, to do some shopping like my sister did in Turkey, and she spent the fortune of the family. Okay. Pretty interesting. Now, I will give you an example. But before giving you this example, now it's Sunday, so you will listen to some good music. Okay, the beginning, now I have to listen to that famous song. Oh my God. Beginning gross. Okay, beginning cost, you will see I'm talking about what? Plus the purchases, plus minus sale or disposal of fixed assets at gross or at cost. And we have the ending gross or cost. First, I want you to understand the terminology cost, gross, book value, net book value, carrying amount, what's the meaning of that? Okay, I have machinery, okay, $200,000. This is the cost, this is the gross. I purchased, when I first purchased this machine, I paid $200,000, or I just purchased it for $200,000, okay? Let's assume that it's a 20-year machine and there's a depreciation of $10,000 per year, straight line method, okay? The accumulated depreciation after 5 years is $50,000, okay? So the net book value, or the net, or the carrying amount of the asset is $150,000. This is the cost or gross when I first purchased my asset, minus the accumulated depreciation. This is the net book value, the carrying amount, the net of the fixed asset is $150,000, okay? When you report your fixed assets in your balance sheet, you put the gross minus the accumulated depreciation, this is the net book value. The accumulated depreciation, it's a contra asset account, okay? This is first, just to clarify the cost, gross, net book value, carrying amount. Okay, I do not want you to make silly mistakes because of this very simple terminology. Okay, now I want you to know. I want you to know two important things regarding fixed assets. Okay, when you make Excel sheets regarding depreciation, you put your beginning gross or cost, okay? And you put here, for example, car 1, car 2, car 3, movie, Disney Pixel, and you put your beginning gross. I purchased this car for $10,000, that one for $15,000, and that one for $50,000, okay? And after that, this is a new one. Maybe in year 2, I acquired car 4. This is okay, the car for $10,000. This is a new addition to your car's collection for $10,000 as well. So this is a purchase. And you sold that one, okay? When you sell this one, you have to make minus 15K because when you purchase the car, you put car, it's a fixed asset, okay, in the debit side. And on a yearly basis, you make the following: depreciation expense, debit, and accumulated depreciation in the credit side because the car is depreciated now. Okay, and when you sell your car, you put the car in the credit side for the same gross amount. You cancel all the accumulated depreciation in the debit side. If you received cash, you debit your cash because the cash increased. If it's a gain, obviously it's going to be in the credit side, and if it's a loss, it's going to be in the debit side, okay? And the last column in your Excel is going to be the end gross. Why? Because when your beginning gross or cost, okay, you add the value of the purchase fixed assets that you purchase, obviously, and you remove the gross or the cost of the assets that you sold, okay, disposal or sale, and this is how you get your ending gross or cost. Okay, if my beginning gross is $10,000 and I purchased, let us take that example. It's 10 plus 15 plus 50, 76, 75,000. Okay, I purchased one more car for $10,000 and I sold that one at gross cost. It's gross or cost was 15, minus 15. So, 78,000. Okay, $70,000 is your ending gross or cost. This is very simple. Okay, it's like if you're working on your Excel formula. I want you to know that for the statement of cash flow and for other stuff, you will see how it works. The second thing I want you to know is the following. The beginning accumulated depreciation. Year 1 plus depreciation of year 2 minus the accumulated depreciation of the asset that is sold in year 2. This is the ending accumulated depreciation year 2. You have to know that, okay? It's always like that. Especially you use that formula while working on an Excel, the Excel of the assets you have. You have a certain beginning accumulated depreciation you start with, okay? Any depreciation expense, it will increase the accumulated depreciation, okay? And when you sell an asset, you will remove that accumulated depreciation, and this is how you will get the ending accumulated depreciation. You can use the journal entry, beginning accumulated depreciation, usually the accumulated depreciation, it's in the credit side. Let's assume that I had $70,000 accumulated depreciation. When you make the depreciation, you debit the depreciation expense and you credit the accumulated depreciation. So the accumulated depreciation is increasing. This is why it's a plus. When you sell a car, you credit the car at gross or at cost and you debit the accumulated depreciation. When you debit the accumulated depreciation will decrease. This is why it's a minus. And this is how you will get the ending accumulated depreciation end of year 2. Obviously, the beginning accumulated depreciation is year 1. depreciation minus accumulated depreciation. Ending accumulated depreciation, this is related to year 2. My starting point is year 1 and everything else is related to year 2. So you have to know both of these formulas regarding assets, okay? This is formula number 2. It's not a formula, it's pure logic. And you use it while building your Excel. All right. Now, I want you to know 2 more things. Keep these formulas in mind. They are very important. They will help you to solve a lot of problems. Okay. Regarding the financing section, I said previously that dividends paid, not declared. Okay, DD, I don't care about DD, my friend. Dividends declared, I don't care about dividends declared. I care about the dividends paid, financing. Dividends received, obviously, operating direct money. The dividends paid, sometimes they will not give you the dividends paid in the exam. You have to calculate it. We all know that our beginning retained earnings plus the net income minus dividends paid, it's the ending retained earnings. If you have your beginning retained earnings, if you have your ending retained earnings and the net income of the year, you can extract and easily calculate the dividends paid to report it under the financing section. So for the financing section, if you do not have the amount of dividends paid, you can just use your beginning retained earnings plus the net income minus dividends paid. It's equal to the ending retained earnings. If my beginning retained earnings is $100,000 and my net income is $50,000 minus dividends paid and my ending retained earnings is $110,000. I'll say 150 minus 110, it's $40,000. So the dividends paid are $40,000. I report in the financing section, dividends paid, they are paid, it's a negative figure, minus $40,000 because I pay cash, I pay dividends to my lucky shareholders. Ooh, okay. So this is, like, I don't know, but I'm trying to make a map. You might not understand everything right now, but you will understand everything after a few minutes and after solving some exercises. What about bonds payable? Bonds payable, beginning bonds payable, plus any issuance of bonds, minus any redemption of bonds, it's your ending bonds payable. Okay, when you issue bonds, your cash increases in the debit side, okay, and you report the bonds payable in the credit side. It's an extra liability, so your liability is going up, it's increasing. This is why it's a plus issuance. Redemption, I will not dive into the details of the redemption because the journal entry is way more complicated than this one. But you have to know that if you are redeeming bonds, the bonds payable will go down, less liability. This is why it's a minus figure. And the answer is the ending bonds payable, okay? So if they are talking about bonds payable, about issuance, redemption, think about the following. Your bonds payable, the beginning bonds payable, plus any issuance, because when you issue bonds payable, your liability goes up, it increases. Minus redemption, when you redeem the bond payable go down. This is how you can get your ending bonds payable, okay? And now we will start our exercises, MCQs, if you want, simulations. I know you like when I do it, and I would like to thank everyone on Facebook. You are writing so many amazing, nice things. I'm really happy. Thank you so much. So let's solve the following, okay? I'm giving you some information. I have the December 31 year 2, and I have here December 31 year 1, okay? The accumulated depreciation here, accumulated depreciation, is $200,000, and the accumulated depreciation here is $150,000. I'm giving you more info. We sold the truck, okay, we sold the truck. The carrying amount of the truck is $60,000. The cost of the truck is $100,000. I would like you to calculate depreciation of year two, because if you are using the indirect method, the operating section, okay, you need to calculate the depreciation to add back this non-cash item. You will tell me, but we are working on the investing and financing section. You have to understand this, okay? You have to understand this to understand the investing and the financing section. I told you two things about the assets. First, the beginning gross assets or at cost plus any purchase minus sales of fixed assets at gross or cost. This is your ending gross or cost fixed assets. But they are not telling me anything about the beginning gross fixed assets and the ending gross fixed assets. So I will not use this one. And I told you something else. The beginning accumulated depreciation of year one plus depreciation of year two minus accumulated depreciation of any asset that is sold, it will give you your ending accumulated depreciation year two. In that example, the accumulated depreciation year one, it's $150,000. Year two, it's $200,000. Depreciation, I have to calculate this, it's a question mark. Minus accumulated depreciation of the asset that is sold. I have to work on this area. The cost, the gross, is $100,000. Minus the accumulated depreciation, it will give me the carrying amount or the net book value or the net of $60,000. 100 minus 40, obviously, it's going to give you $60,000. So the accumulated depreciation of the asset that is sold is minus 40. 150 minus 40 is 110. 110 plus how much give me 200? It's $90,000. So the depreciation is $90,000. This is what is to be reported in the operating section under the indirect method. Okay, I'm not talking about the investing. I'm not talking about the financing so far, but I want you to understand this concept to dive more into the details of the investing and the financing section. Now, another example. I know I'm trying to move quickly, but try to focus and write down everything we are saying on a piece of paper so that you understand the concept better. This is year one, this is year two. Pay attention in the exam. Sometimes year one is here, sometimes year two is here. Sometimes year two is here, sometimes year one is here. So be focused, read well, and pay attention. The fixed assets, gross or cost, year one, $38,000, year two, $42,000. The accumulated depreciation is $2,400, $3,600. And the net, the carrying amount, the net book value of the assets is this one minus this one, obviously. Okay, it's going to give you $35,600, $38,400. Okay, in year two, Sara Co. Sold an asset. The cost of the asset is $6,000 and the book value of the asset is $4,200. Okay? And so in year two, Sara Co. sold an asset. These are the information regarding the asset for $2,000 cash. Okay? And purchased fixed assets for $10,000. This is nice. Budget. Okay, you have to think about the following. I want you now to see the investing section, because I'm talking about the fixed assets. And I want you to see the operating section as well, okay? You have to have a clear vision about everything. We said previously that our beginning gross or cost plus any purchase minus sale at gross or cost, it will give me my ending gross or cost. Let's verify the following, okay? Beginning gross or cost is a new one. This is the beginning. It was $38,000. Plus any purchase. They told me that they purchased a fixed asset for $10,000. plus $10,000 minus any sale at gross. They sold the asset and the cost of that asset, the gross of that asset was $6,000 minus $6,000. It will give me the ending gross. This is 42. Let's verify the following. 38 plus 10, 48. 48 minus 42. This is working. The formula is correct. You see, it's very simple. So we verified the first formula regarding the beginning gross. Now let's do the beginning accumulated depreciation. Beginning accumulated depreciation plus it's in E1 plus depreciation of year 2 minus accumulated depreciation of the asset that is sold in year 2. It will give me my ending accumulated depreciation. Beginning accumulated depreciation in one, $2,400. I will continue here. So it's $2,400 plus depreciation. I don't know what's my depreciation expense. Minus accumulated depreciation for the asset that is sold. If the cost of the asset was $6,000, okay? And if it's the net, the carrying amount, the net book value is $4,200. So its total accumulated depreciation was 6 minus 4,200. It's 1,800, right? So minus $1,800. It will give me my ending accumulated depreciation year 2, $3,600. 2,400 minus 1,800, it's 600. 600 plus how much give me $3,600? It's $3,000. So my depreciation expense is $3,000. If you're using the indirect method, you will report this depreciation expense, okay, under the operating section. Now, what about the investing section? I told you previously that the purchase of any fixed asset and the sale of any fixed asset is reported under the investing section for the amount of cash. They told me that in year 2, Sarako sold the asset, cost $6,000, book value $4,200, for $2,000. I just care about cash, investing section. They sold it for $2,000. I don't care about its cost. I don't care about its book value. I don't care about its accumulated depreciation. I just care about dollars. I don't care about dollars. So in year 2, Sarako sold the assets for $2,000. When you sell something, your cash increases. So asset that is sold under the investing section plus $2,000 because your cash increased. And I just care about the amount of cash. I told you if I calculate the depreciation, I can use it to be reported under the indirect operating section. Okay? And they purchased fixed assets for $10,000. Well, I just care about the cash. I purchased a fixed asset for $10,000. This is very simple. When I purchase an asset, I pay cash. My cash decreases. So the purchase of asset is for minus $10,000. And in this case, the total is minus $8,000 for the investing section. So please pay attention. If they're talking about fixed assets are to be reported under the investing section, yes. You might need to calculate the depreciation in case you are working on the operating section and especially the indirect method. And what you need to report under the investing section is that just for the amount of cash. If I'm selling for $2,000, I report plus $2,000. I don't care about cost. I don't care about book value. I don't care about accumulated depreciation. And if I purchase a fixed asset for $10,000, I will say purchase minus $10,000. If they are telling me I'm purchasing a fixed asset for a note payable, I don't care. It's a non-cash item. I do not report it. Okay? So that was an example to understand the relation between investing and operating section. I still have a few exercises. Now I want you to analyze something very interesting with me. I will give you a list of facts. We will see what is reported under the investing and the financing section. Okay, we will make a quick analysis. I have proceeds from sale of an equipment, $5,000. I have gain on the sale of the equipment, $3,000. I have a purchase of bonds for 90 $1,000. Par is $100K. Okay. Amortization of the bond discount is $1,000. I have Didi, dividends declared. Yes, you remember Didi? Didi, my friend? $30,000. And I have dividends paid, $19,000. I have dividends collected on stock inventory. On stock investment. $20,000. So dividends collected on stock investment, and I have proceeds from sale of stock for $37,500, and the carrying amount is $29K. What is to be reported under the investing section? What is to be reported under the financing section? Let's make a quick analysis. Proceeds from sale of equipment. Whenever I sell fixed assets, whenever I purchase fixed assets, it's reported under the investing section. Yes, sir, investing section. This is correct. Gain on the sale of the equipment. Gain on the sale of the fixed assets. I told you, I do care about the gain when I'm working on the operating section, the indirect method. First, it's the indirect, not the direct method. Second, it's the operating section. So I will not use that one to calculate the amount that is reported under the investing or the financing section. I do not need it. I need it if I'm working on the operating section under the indirect method. Okay, they are telling me they are purchasing bonds. I told you previously, when you see bonds payable, it does not mean that it's reported under the financing section. You have to see whether there are redemption, issuance, proceeds from issuance, or just purchase of bonds, purchase of HTM, purchase of equity securities. So purchase of bonds payable, it's investing section for $90,000. I do not care about the par, I just care about cash. We all care about cash. Do not forget this. So this is investing section because it's a purchase of bonds, not proceeds, not redemption, okay? Amortization of bond discount. I care about the amortization of bond discount. Yeah, this is true, I care about it. If I was working on the operating section, the indirect method, and we saw that in cash flows part one. So do I need the amortization of bond discounts when I'm working on the investing and financing section? No, sir, I do not need it. So I'll remove this one. What about DD, dividends declared? The dividends declared. I don't care about DD. The dividends have to be paid, received or collected, but declared, no one cares. Remove it. Dividends paid, yes, dividends paid is financing section. Dividends paid, financing section. This is correct. Dividends collected, dividends received, I care about it when I'm working on the operating section, the direct method. Okay, you care about the dividends collected, the dividends received on stock investment, but not here. Okay, so I will remove it. Proceeds from sale, proceeds, this is the keyword, proceeds from sale of stock, proceeds from issuance of bonds. Yes, this is reported under the financing section. Do I care about the carrying amount? No, I care about the cash for $37,500. Okay, so two elements in the investing section and two elements in my financing section. I have to pay attention to the signs. Okay, it's a plus or it's a minus. Proceeds from sale. When I sell something, my cash goes up, so it's a plus figure. Purchase. When I purchase something, I pay cash, my cash goes down, minus. Plus $5,000, minus $90,000. The answer is minus $95,000. This is the investing section. What about the financing? Dividends paid, I'm paying. When I pay, my cash goes down, it's a minus. Proceeds from sale, when I sell something, my cash goes up, plus. So it's minus 19,000 plus 37. Is that number 18,500, this is the total, that's a plus, okay? This is the total of the financing section. I hope you started understanding this concept more and more after all these videos. One more example. Come on guys, you have to study and we're studying together. You will pass your CPA exam. I know it's hard, it's time consuming, it's energy consuming, but you will do it. No one is better than you. You can do it, yes. Whoa, whoa, whoa. Sara Co, I have a huge business. Sara Co acquired a 25k 2-year certificate of deposit from a bank. I told you in the introductory part that any acquisition of a COD is reported under the investing section, and obviously it's a negative figure, it's a minus, okay? An interest of $1,500 was paid. Sara Co sold an investment. The carrying value of the investment is $15,000, and she sold it for, because I'm talking about myself, for $18,000. Sara Co, lucky Sara, acquired a stock for 11K. Okay? She is intending, Sara Co is intending to hold this stock as a long-term investment. Okay, the dividends paid to the shareholders, $1,200, and the dividends collected or received on the stock investment is $18,000, whatever. Okay, I don't care about it. Let's analyze the following. How? Okay, Sara Co acquired a $25,000 2-year certificate of deposit from a bank, investing section, as we said previously. And whenever you acquire a certificate of deposit, it's a negative figure. So this is the investing section minus 25K. This is the bullet point number one. An interest of $1,500 was paid. Interest paid, I care about it when I'm working on the following. I'm using the direct method first. And I'm working on the operating section. So do I need this while dealing with the investing and financing section? No, because it's interest paid, okay? Sara Co sold an investment. Do I care about the carrying value? No, I don't. I just care about the amount of cash. So for $18,000, yes, I care about the for $18,000. Whenever I sell an investment, I care about the cash amount, okay? For $18,000, let me write this here. For $18,000, for 18K. Sara Co acquired stock for $18,000. Let us leave it. And she's intending to hold it as a long-term investment. Okay, I know that. Dividends paid $1,200. This is important for the financing section. Dividends collected on stock investment. I care about it if I'm working on the operating section, the direct method, so I do not need it in that example. Okay, Sara Co sold an investment. When you sell an investment, it's plus $18,000. Okay, whenever you sell an investment, it's a plus figure. And when you acquire, it's a minus figure. Okay, minus $11,000. So, for the financing section, it's minus because the dividends are paid. It's minus $1,200. This is what is to be reported under the financing section. What about the investing section? It's minus $25,000 plus the $18,000 because you sold your investment and you gained cash. And you acquired stock minus $11,000. Whenever you sell an investment, whenever you acquire a stock, it's reported under the investing section. Minus 25, minus 11, it's minus 36. Minus 36 plus 18. Is minus $18,000. This is reported under the investing section And under the financing section, I just have to put the dividends that are paid. Whoa, one last example. I want you to practice as many MCQs as possible, as many simulations as possible. I'm trying to solve a few MCQs, but I'm trying to clarify the whole concept because I want you to be able to solve MCQs and simulations after watching this video, okay? Now, the last example. Sara Co. reported the following. $95,000 at December 31, year 1, and $45,000 at 31 or December 31, year 2. Okay? In year 2, Sara Co. issued, I'm talking about bonds payable, sorry. So issued $10,000 of BP bonds payable in exchange for a truck. You have to calculate the redemption of bonds payable to be reported in year 2 statement of cash flow. How to do it? It's very simple. You're beginning bonds payable, year 1 obviously, plus any issuance, okay, in year 2, minus any redemption in year 2. This is going to give you your ending bonds payable, means at year in year 2. Bonds payable, the beginning it was $95,000, the ending it was $45,000, the issuance it's $10,000. 95 plus 10, 105. 105 minus how much it gives you? 45. Okay, it's going to be $60,000. So this is